Welcome to my humble medical marijuana garden. Please allow me to introduce myself. If you Google Jack Herer Carl Packard 1989, you can read about our forcing the Library of Congress to accept the movie Hemp For Victory back into their catalog after it was illegally removed. We were involved in other actions that year, but none held up as well over time. That was my first year as a marijuana revolutionary. Come to find out, Jack spent the rest of his life talking about our exploits. He was a wonderful teacher. It seems like it was only recently we were together. But it was 25 years ago now. I've been a full-time professional organic marijuana grower ever since. Now I'm a legal patient in Rhode Island, and help other patients and caregivers grow. I remember Jack Herer saying that declaring a moratorium on the marijuana war like they did in Vietnam is by far the most important issue today. Most people want to attach onto safe issues like saving the dolphin. Once we legalize cannabis hemp again, we can direct our attention on saving the human race from destroying itself. Sometime soon we will have to face the consequences for our actions or inactions. This planet is literally going to be hell on earth unless everyone wakes from their sleep. A place that unfortunately we all play a role in creating. Most people will die not even knowing they were a part of the problem. This was just a small slice of the world according to Jack Herer. I recently wrote out the story of my time with Jack. You can click on the Facebook links in video comments. Stretching our reach. Willing to be patient while trying to teach. You can also tune into AnonMarijuana on Facebook, Twitter and Google+. Dare to struggle. Dare to win. For if you dare not struggle, you will not win. You can make a difference one person at a time. You are the knight in shining armor you have been waiting for. Panic. Do anything. Just don't do nothing and expect blind faith to show you the light. Things are going to get a lot worse before they can get any better. The sooner we face the pain in letting the Industrial Revolution die, the easier it will be to recover. I spent a total of 5 years in prison, on 2 marijuana cultivation charges. I spent time with murderers, bank robbers, child rapers, a man who cooked his baby in a microwave, and all sorts of degenerate types. And I spent 5 years as a marijuana fugitive. I could have gotten a life sentence with the feds. When the state finally caught me, I only did 3 days while they discovered the evidence and money were gone. I never gave up. I never lost hope. As a drug war victim, when the time is right, I will seek an apology and compensation for human rights violations and psychological damages. Oh sure, it could always have been worse. My manhood was never questioned. My anus was left unmolested. Yes, it is always good to look for the good, and learn your lessons, no matter how much you lose in all you have invested in on this physical plane. Never let your defeats keep you down. When society knocks you down, keep getting back up. I am still recovering financially, and emotionally, from my last 3.5 year prison bid for marijuana cultivation 4+ years ago. For 3 years after getting out, I collected discarded grow room equipment handed down to me. And I collected everything I would need to start my own small medical marijuana garden on a shoestring budget. I lived simply and close to nature while camping in the woods most of those first 3 years. Through my lifetime, I have survived several adrenal overloads. They are called nervous breakdowns, and have a few slang words to describe the condition back through written time. These mental nutties were at times severe, as they waxed and waned hallucinogenic for months and year-long spells. They wanted to fill me full of pills in assorted rainbow colors. These pills I discovered block the light. To nature's hum they leave you deaf and dumb. The psychiatric establishment does not want you to realize that they and the government are in collusion together, and part of the problem. Through knowledge and nature, I was able to rewire my fried mental circuits and recover from the debilitating effects caused by overstimulation, or technology poisoning, and the accumulation of stress caused from living life outside the natural order of things as they were intended. I came to see clearly how our primal instincts conflict with social obligations and gender roles. This is the root to many, if not all, social and world problems. Knowledge and nature are free. They are also the answer to finding true freedom from mental and physical slavery, and from capitalist oppression at war with all that is natural. Enlightenment for me was in part a process of relearning, after realizing everything I learned was a lie. We the people have been successfully divided and conquered through language, race, morals, ethics and fear. Together as a whole we can rise against our oppressors. I started out using Google Translate to read and write well enough, having worked my way around 7 languages. Translating foreign pages today seems only a left or right click away. This allows us here to keep our fingers on the pulse of intergalactic cannabis. My line recently getting hot attention, please forgive me, I wish not to offend, I got this idea from Jack Herer who is Jewish, we are being used as scapegoats by capitalist interests similar to the Jews in the Nazi war. Another final solution? The angels must come to call it never never more. My posts are not hateful. Marijuana prohibition is just plain evil. Only recently have a couple of states decriminalized marijuana for some people. We still have a few holdout haters and oppressors, or those with a financial interest in keeping the status quo as it is. They whine about the message that marijuana legalization would send to the children. Save the children, they cry, while turning our planet into a burnt French fry. The less you think about your oppression, the more tolerance for it grows. But to become free, you have to be aware of being a slave. The drug war has proven itself a failure in many ways. In this aspect and many others, our government has failed us. Have we not seen for ourselves how governments create a problem, get a reaction, then offer the solution? You want to introduce something you know the people won't like. So you first create a problem, a rising crime rate, more violence, a terrorist bomb. You make sure someone else is blamed for this problem. So you create a patsy, as they call them in America, a Timothy McVeigh or a Lee Harvey Oswald. This brings us to stage 2, the reaction from the people. This can't go on. What are they going to do about it? This allows them to then openly offer the solution to the problems they have created. There are several indicators that would lead me to expect the ruling class to implement a full-scale police state. This includes the billions of dollars recently spent building concentration-type FEMA camps, and hundreds of billions on militarizing the police. And then there is United Nations Agenda 21. While its cover is deceptively green, inside it is a death sentence for 1 billion earthlings. It would do you well to go to the website postsustainabilityinstitute.org. It is there you will discover what the world government's solution is to the problem they created. Isn't it ironic that with our own hard-earned taxes we are paying for our own oppression, destruction and misery? Here is a new word for you that they have in store for us, communitarianism. Communitarianism is a social and political philosophy that emphasizes the importance of the common good over the individual. Communitarianism will sound a death knell for human rights and autonomy. Be forewarned that in the future it will in effect become illegal to not have a job or place to live. When mandatory housing, employment and education is voted for by the people, at first what sounds sweet turns to rancid meat. Take Hitler for example. And he was Jewish by the way. The infrastructures are in place to accommodate the next problem, and it won't be drugs. The next scourge to plague America will be the unemployed, homeless and uneducated. The current democratic institutions are not only failing us, they are making our lives unbearable. They get our hopes up, and tell us change is coming. Then stomp all our hopes and dreams to dust, left to blow in the wind. In the future, as times inevitably change for the worse, being able to readily adapt to change will enhance your survival equation. For now take their handouts, but be prepared for the tap to run dry. When this happens, a whole class segment of society will be prone to engage in criminal activity to feed themselves and their families. For those without jobs and places to live, it is not going to be safe to congregate together in tent cities and let yourself be seen. When there are too many of you, you will be rounded up, and forced to labor for the privilege to live. Now that the homeless are being sent to FEMA camps for political indoctrination, you that are still free, and can see, should for sport, head for the swamps and deep woods to build yourself a secret doomsday fort. Learn now to live with nature. It will be easier transitioning to a life living in nature rather than it being forced upon you in chaos and crisis. Learn how to forage for wild food, catch wild game, and fish. Learn how to simplify your life and live as primitively as possible. Practice invisibility when camping out. Learn the secrets of stealth camping and gardening. Practice sneaking into and out of nature settings without tracks or trace. Practice walking the railroad tracks without being detected by the Amtrak police, who now have regular patrols on every stretch. Think about why you would want to act and live like a hunted animal. We can see for ourselves how using technology and accumulating wealth for the sake of progress and success is absurd, as at its root lies death and destruction. While using technology and investing wealth today to better enhance our survival equation after the economy crash is not absurd, because it is rooted in biologic. Our culture cannot continue indefinitely to wage global wars for the purpose of resource acquisition. And we cannot continue to consume and poison our host forever. One way to have a peaceful revolution is to just stop paying taxes. So we here resign ourselves to the fact that eventually we will as a whole crash and burn, as every technological civilization has done before us. It is no longer a question of if technology will crash, but when. Start thinking about post-sustainability. Maybe we'll get it right next time. To overthrow the global economic system sounds like a dream. I wish we could all scream. Why postpone for our children to endure alone the inevitable? The revolution is not something our oppressors will televise. It is going to happen live, before our very eyes. Losing our wits, sucking off technology's tits. On the final stretch, life lessons are the fuel. Do we make it to the finish line before we retch, or become hate's tool? Hold on, it's going to be one hell of a ride. While to the bottom of a greased pole we inevitably slide. Only after the crash, will we be able to rebuild from the ash. The junkie does not like the rig, yet together they dance a beautiful jig. A moment of silence please, if we may, for the casualties and prisoners of war, and missing in action. Understanding how the 1% can control the 99%, so that you can say no to their game, would involve absorbing knowledge on several topics. The psychology of fear controls us. By instilling fear in us, we are more easily controlled. It makes us afraid of ridicule and rejection if we speak out against an oppressive reality determined by popular consensus. It is fear that causes us to deny the possibility of a reality determined by minority consensus. This only limits our ability to realize our fullest potential. While the psychology of oppression gets us down, and keeps us down and feeling as if we cannot make a difference. And in better understanding the psychology of morals and ethics, you will understand better why good people disagree, and why good people cannot get along. And in the transfer of oppression, the oppressed become the oppressors in a vicious cycle whereby our oppressors are themselves oppressed, and think those they oppress are the root to their displeasure. We recently started compiling playlists of videos here on our YouTube channel that we feel are relative to all our interests in one way or another. The playlist, Understanding Our Oppression and Past, is a collection that touches on topics never taught us in school. And the playlist, Plant Psychology 101, would be essential for those who would like to take a deeper look inside the behavior and life of plants. And the book, The Secret Life of Plants by Peter Tompkins would be mandatory reading here for anyone interested in taking a class. In learning from past lessons, we have seen that striking violently at our oppressors only gives them reason to oppress us more. Once you come to understand transfer of oppression, you will realize how it is important to spend energy now trying to shed light into the dark void of intolerance and hate. Use the force. Love yourself. Tap into what love has to offer. It is in every one of you. Let go of your fears. This is one way they control you. There is no place for fear in a warrior's life. That does not mean reckless abandonment either. Fear is a child's emotion. A revolutionary must be willing to walk away from their life, and carry only what they can, with only a 30-second warning. Life really only begins at the point where you begin to stretch the boundaries. Do not be afraid of losing technology's perks. Because in order to enjoy them, we must follow man's laws, which are convoluted, twisted upside down and backwards, and used as population control on an earth-shattering seismic scale. When the dust settles after the technology crash, when there is no gas for the gas stations, or groceries for the grocery stores, or money to pay the police, then we can get back to real freedom. Freedom is what the Indians had before we came here to America and tried to exterminate them all. In being willing to let it all go, at the same time we will be gaining it all by aligning ourselves with the fifth dimension, and nature's laws, the natural order of things as they were intended. While the unhappy and dispossessed get themselves killed in the streets, playing their roles in population controls. While in the spirit world, violent death fans the pyres of hell. While at the same time there will be those living wild like hunted animals in the woods, waiting for the dust to settle. While in revolution and politics, we seem forced to meddle. Have no doubt that foreign United Nations troops in this country, and our United Nations troops in other countries will not be able to maintain control. But they will play a part in the prime directive that the planet is overpopulated, and 1 billion resistors to communitarianism must die. Jack Herer used to say, "Of course in the end we will win the war because we have more time than they have money." No matter how indignantly we try to wash our hands of it, we are accomplices to this evil we all created in our actions or lack of actions. We will all pay a tremendous price and sacrifice for the actions of our forefathers. What better time than now to prepare for the end of life as we know it? It will be survival of the fittest once again, living by nature's laws, not man's.
I have a dream. I have a dream that one day in the libraries, parks, and streets on every continent, that the sons of the oppressed, and the sons of former oppressors, will be able to sit down together at the table of humanity, and not stay silent about things that matter, for they will understand that is when life begins to end.
I recently graduated to the world of humanism. Humanity serves up an enormous plate of discontent. With so many groups watering down the stench of our suffering caused by the deep-rooted inequality of social disparity, we need to gather together where we can all fly our bitch rant together. We can do this under the banner of humanism. Many causes have been effectively stigmatized and attacked by those who do not understand them. It is easy for people to attack what they do not understand. Cannabis marijuana hemp is certainly one cause that has been greatly misunderstood and distorted. What I have observed over time is that the feminist cause has also been misunderstood and distorted. I have discovered that humanism is a better arena to try to present the old-school feminist angle on the tyranny and oppression of patriarchy. On the topic of feminists, some people I know comment on angry bull dykes and lesbians wanting to either eliminate men or be like men. Because of the negative publicity directed toward feminism over time, many who support and push patriarchy thinks it has matriarchy beat. When in fact it has only regrouped and gained momentum with the humanists. If I said that patriarchy is a humanist topic which is at the root of all our oppression, would you be more receptive to it? Well, it seems now that as most people do not understand the root issues, that the answer is yes. It is unfortunate that the original creator's message has been watered down by seething man-haters whose methodology tends to alienate the general public. I am not suggesting that everyone become a humanist, just that you might check it out. It's a place we might all gather at times to support each other's causes. I used to be anonymous. I am only one person. I can make a difference one person at a time. And so can you. Growing marijuana has been my life's passion, even before it became a trendy fashion. I have been an organic grower with full-time professional experience since 1989, my first year in training as a marijuana revolutionary with Jack Herer. My only obligation is to the spirit world to try and do good with the lessons I learn. I am always able to stay positive, upbeat and happy even through the most trying of times, because I realize I am here doing exactly what I came here to do according to my birth visions, when I chose my parents after having seen my life before me. If you are not happy, then it is because you forgot why you came here. Together we can rise up against our oppressors. Hands up, don't shoot. The time has come, I am told I do not have to wear this disguise anymore. On your planet Earth I am called Carl Packard. Being Carl Packard or any human for that matter takes energy. It is easier for me to communicate with you telepathically and manipulate your electronic equipment to communicate with others. The woman that I tricked into creating me, she told me she has been honored to aid in the disguise of my true identity. She said she always knew I was different. And always told me I was special. Unlike some activity, in this medical marijuana mission, size matters. We are starting a project here to grow the largest indoor marijuana plant in the world. Please remember, I am just getting back on my feet from my last prison bit. This is growing on a shoestring. If I didn't use what was lying around and what I could piece together from hand-me-downs, I would still be a dream growing ding-a-ling. I could have been a millionaire by now had the government not wasted $500,000 trying to brainwash me with 5 years worth of prison time, and if I had not spent 5 years as a fugitive running from the law. So as I rebuild my life once again, you can watch me, and grow with me if you like. There are as many ways to grow as there are growers. I am not going to say that my way produces the most. But I can say it is the most efficient and plant-friendly way I know. And I can say I grow some of the most enlightening marijuana in the universe. I am positive that every grower can gather something from my years of experience. In sharing my lessons, the sacrifice and pain will not be so in vain. What I have gotten into recently is simulating sunlight intensity by using 100 watts of light per square foot. The epiphany recently came in a vision, that with a limit on the numbers of plants allowed, increasing productivity without sacrificing quality can be obtained by increasing light intensity. What I discovered some years ago quite by accident was that increasing the amount of light does not produce bigger buds. What it does is allows them to grow and mature faster. I don't care about saving electricity. Its cost is only around 10% of what the marijuana would have cost if I had to buy it. I don't care about heat because it can be vented. While during winter months the heat from the lights is circulated throughout my living quarters. I do not care about odor because I manage it. What I have here is 4,000 watt lights, in a 6x8 foot space. In our next video you will become more familiar with my setup, which is in of itself a living and breathing machine. It has taken me some time to catch up with my past. That having been mostly completed, you will be able to enjoy with me my ride into the future as we document our progress and expansion here more closely. I will take you further into my confidence with the next video in the series we plan. There is much to get into. We do more than inject marijuanas and nod out at our computer screens here at AnonMarijuana World Headquarters. We cook, clean, and sew. With children to care for, we are blessed. We have hobbies like making tie-dye clothing and sheets. So what happened when the Rasta and hippie met? They mixed up their colors to see what they could get. We make different kinds of musical flutes, and authentic Jamaican jungle smoking Rasta art. We gather as often as possible to watch the moon and play drums around a campfire. We play guitar and other musical instruments. We meditate often, and discuss philosophy, Americanology, and history to great lengths. And we give away quite a bit of our marijuana to patients who truly need it and have a hard time paying dispensary prices, or have a hard time digesting the lack of quality and love in the dispensary product. One thing we do not do here is watch traditional television. Shot it with a 30-odd six back in not 99, an era that started my 5 years as a fugitive while living the good life close to nature and growing marijuana in the woods of Pennsylvania. Please subscribe and stay tuned as we push this concept of simulating sunlight intensity, seek out the largest indoor and outdoor marijuana plants, trek the globe for higher THC levels and unique flavors, make moon rock Japanese pipe rap, go about our arts and crafts, and keep a finger on the pulse of intergalactic cannabis marijuana hemp culture. We support nonviolent forms of disagreement with the powers that seek to enslave us and profit from our blood, sweat, and tears. Together we can break the chains and shackles that bind us to the tyranny of oppression. We came here to blend in and help you with your revolution. We are a legion. We are everywhere. We are your neighbors. We bleed and have feelings. Rest assured, that in the end we will win. We do not forgive. We do not forget. Expect us. Thank you all very much, you have been a wonderful audience. A toast to sunnier days. We all show our love in different ways. Hi there, Amber.
Cut, cut, cut. Someone get the dog.
No, no, you are not in this video. You go sit and watch, okay?
Quiet on the set. Amber, come here.
Declaring a moratorium on the marijuana war like they did in Vietnam is by far the most important issue today. Most people... Cut, cut, cut. Shit, this is not working. Ouch, ouch. Hot.
You okay? Want to take a break?
I am okay.
Focus, everyone. Let's do it over. Back to the beginning.
Together as a whole, we can rise against our oppressors.
Cut, cut, cut. You stood up too soon.
Oh, yeah.
Your mind seems elsewhere, dear.
And forced to labor for the privilege to live. Give. Ah, ah, ah. I forgot the next line.
Cut. Back to the beginning.
Wait a minute. Got something in my eye. I love you, babe. The reaction from the people. This cannot go on. Cut. Who farted?
Smells like alien shit to me. Cork that hole up.
Air this place out a minute. My eyes are watering.
5 minute break, everyone. Go out and fart if you have to.